All right, our next speaker is Deb Roy. Deb is a professor of Media Arts and Sciences at the Media Lab, and he's also the director of the Center for Constructive Communication. And he's going to speak about generative AI and democracy.
Thank you. Actually, that's the last slide in my deck. Can we go to the top of the deck, please? Thank you. Good afternoon. I'd like to share with you some work we are doing in integrating generative AI into social networks with the aim of strengthening democracy. This is work that is being done at the Center for Constructive Communication, which brings together an interdisciplinary group of graduate students and staff. And in particular, I'm going to highlight some work done with Dimitra Kupalu, Jad Kabara, Dennis Chen, and Titi Fan, who is a collaborator from a nonprofit called Cortico. So the backdrop is that we have spent years studying the impact of social media on society, where it's clear if you give anyone the ability to pick up a bullhorn, some will learn how to do it. And the pattern that repeats itself is one of social fragmentation, where the content that gets the most visibility tends to be extreme points of view, often filled with outrage, that divides us. And unfortunately, we can't just put our phones down because that same kind of behavior is leaking into in-person spaces. And what motivates our work is this thought that hearing the humanity in others is necessary for democracy to function. And in spaces where more and more authentic speech is being replaced by performative talk, there is a crisis in trust. And there's a lot of concern now with generative AI as being an additional vector that makes it even difficult to know whether we're dealing with real versus fake content or people. And so it's in this context that I want to share with you some work we're doing in tapping into ancient wisdoms of facilitated dialogue, of deep listening, of organizing, to develop a technology stack from the ground up to create scalable spaces for constructive communication. And in that context, I'll share with you how we're bringing generative AI into the mix. So the concept, just to give you a sense of the ancient wisdoms, is when a large group is having trouble getting along, when there's distrust and toxic polarization, start by creating small circles of trust where there's some existing sense of shared connection, shared experience within the group. Sweet spot, 4 to 6 people. Design conversation prompts that we've been doing working with facilitation experts that encourage people to share experiences rather than opinions. Even opinions and facts civilly presented do not tend to increase trust, respect, and instead, if you listen to experience of others, those factors go up. This is a facilitator-led process where if you have these conditions, people will, in these safe spaces, share authentically. So now we can start to layer in jobs for technology. The first is with the consent of whoever shares that authentic story to be able to carry the voice over to another group and enable listening at a distance. Second, if we can scale these kinds of small group conversations, we have designed both tools and methods to enable what we call sense making, qualitative coding of themes that emerge across conversations, across different stories shared, which can then, with consent, be shared back to the community and, again, with consent, to larger groups of people. So this leads to, in real world terms, the ability to have these conversations around an audio device that we've developed, through online conversations, or through a mobile app, a fully featured social network that has been designed at MIT and that's about to be launched with our nonprofit partner. And listening then happens on the other side, both through the app and through interactive voice portals. So this I share this with you to give you the context where we have actually with a nonprofit partner, Cortico, deployed this method and a set of technologies that are now being adopted by local governments around the United States with youth-centered organizations and emerging areas, including journalism and bringing this platform into the workplace. We've started piloting at MIT, in fact, and working with citizen assemblies. So to summarize the context, rather than a social media platform designed for virality, what we've actually created is a social network with these small groups and jobs to be done by people, to be a facilitator, to be an organizer, to actually invite people in to small group conversations, to be a curator, the equivalent of content recommendation in a social media network for which stories should be heard across groups. Conversation designers, that the original prompt designers for human prompting, and this kind of sense making. Each of these jobs is done by someone in the community in these partner projects that we've been running across the country. Since they are all communication-centered tasks, it is natural, and we have started exploring the use of large language models, a form of generative AI, to scale these networks. But for us, it's key that we stick to the original aims of creating social networks that foster constructive communication. So I just wanted to zoom in on one of these jobs to be done. In fact, the most laborious, a lot of listening, a lot of qualitative coding involved in doing the sense making, but very powerful in unlocking patterns of connection across groups that might think they have nothing in common. And so what we began by doing is, given a collection of speech recordings made by groups, we used large language models in a iterative prompted method to create code books, themes and sub-themes that emerge from collections of speech, to then use a second large language model layer to apply those themes and sub-themes to the content. And then, as I'm sure everyone here is aware, you can create fluid summaries of pieces of content, so kind of like beads on a string, pull out pieces of conversations that are all aligned along a certain theme and create thematic summaries. And so when we look at the code books that are generated using this approach and their quality, they're high. This is an example, actually, of themes and sub-themes that emerge from conversations held at MIT about how people are experiencing the values of MIT in their everyday life here in our community. Those tags are then applied. We've measured with relatively high accuracy to content from these conversations. The summaries are fluid. They automatically, we've found ways to link the summaries back to content, so they're actually grounded summaries. And there's a problem, which is, in our work, in our experience with human sense-making teams, there are often occurrences where the interpretation of a personal story or a piece of content from a conversation depends on human perspective. So I just want to give you one concrete example. 2 years ago, we hosted conversations with hundreds of people from low-income communities of color from every neighborhood around Boston, asking the question, what is a hope or concern you have about the future of Boston and your place in that future? And what's an experience you've had related to that hope or concern? 40% of the responses to that open-ended prompt were stories related to housing. Some of our sense makers labeled many of those conversations with the theme homelessness. And we actually have a method in our qualitative coding to actually write down a definition that our team agrees with. We also had some community fellows that grew up in some of those neighborhoods that were part of our team, and they had a very different perspective. They labeled some of those same stories, not all, but some, as housing instability. And if you look at the definition, one is the experience of actually having difficulty paying rent and so forth that leads temporarily to a situation, versus an institutional view, say if you're in the housing department in the city, of homelessness. There is no, in our opinion, correct answer for what's the right theme. It depends on the perspective. So the idea that an AI system could just automate this is, in our opinion, the wrong way to think about the role of AI. So what we have done is created, essentially, a steering wheel that attaches to the large language model. So a human sense maker has a new role, in this case, to actually edit both thematic tags and definitions, and then iteratively inspect how they are applied to collections of speech and the summaries that are created, and iterate until they are satisfied with the interpretation of a collection of community speech. A side effect of all of this is that those roles create both authority and responsibility for one or more people in the community to actually interpret the voice of others. And if those people are visible, they actually become a point of contact for others in the community. So that kind of human connection allows people to actually give input and feedback to this interpretation process. So to summarize, the way that we are looking at each of the roles in the social network that over the last few years we've developed is to think of generative AI as a very powerful new source of technology to create scaffolding, where the principles that we adhere to are that these roles remain human-led and AI-assisted, regardless of efficiencies, because of the context we're working in. We see the system we're designing as a theory of democracy, that there's ways to participate in democracy that go beyond voting, and that the last thing we'd want to do is automate those roles away. Instead, that we use the AI as a way to develop human capacity in these various roles that have byproducts beyond the specific task to be done, and ultimately foster human-human connection. So although there are a lot of concerns about generative AI as a source of threat, which I agree with, we're exploring here a very different way to channel these capabilities to create stronger social networks for democracy. Thank you.